Okay, I'll try. Brain-computer interfaces for intelligent systems. And I want to look at BCI interests nowadays. And my feeling is that we can say that we are going into the direction of using BCI for smart and playful applications. Both are useful, I think. Why do I think that? Because, well, if you compare the situation now with, let's say, 10 years ago, then nowadays I only show the books, of course, in which I'm involved. So I edited these books. The handbook of BCI will appear next year. But there are lots of books nowadays on brain-computer interfaces. Not only lots of books, also lots of roadmaps. So the European Union, for example, started a roadmap in 2012, the left one on future BCI. The other started in 2012. The first one started a little early. The roadmap, the blue one, started in 2013, 2014. It was finished last year, in 2015. And also in Korea or DARPA, they are looking at brain-computer interfaces and what can we expect from them outside the clinical domain, because brain-computer interfaces are already well-known, well-established field of research in the clinical domain for medical applications. But maybe nowadays we can look at applications that are more in the, let's say, the regular domain of abled users. There are lots of publications nowadays. I only have until 2013, but I've also seen numbers that go until 2015. So journals, scientific journals publishing about BCI. There are lots of nice devices. So the left one is 1924 in a laboratory of Hans Berger in Germany. And then the person, the subject, had electrodes on his head and a room full of devices in order to measure that brain activity that comes through the electrodes. And nowadays we see pictures like this. So we have, for example, very attractive devices. We have combinations with virtual reality. We have combinations with eye tracking, for example, or with Google Glasses. And we have different applications. Applications is maybe too much, because it's usually in laboratory or in artistic environments where people compete using BCI. So you have two people where brain activity is measured and something is doing with the integration of the brain activity, or people that collaborate, of people that perform. So in the right one, you have about 40 people using a very simple BCI device in order to manipulate an audiovisual landscape. So very different from what you see in clinical applications. Lots of predictions. Let me see if this works.
Mind reading is no longer science fiction. From Houdini to Skywalker, mind reading has merely been wishful thinking for science fiction fans for decades, but their wish may soon come true.
Within 5 years, we'll begin to see early applications of this technology. Beyond PC games, doctors could use the technology to test brain patterns, possibly even assist in rehabilitation and to help in understanding brain disorders such as autism. IBM scientists are researching how to link your brain to your devices, such as a computer or a smartphone, so you just need to think about calling someone and it happens. And perhaps many years in the future, if you want to type something, don't need to say a word or hit a single key, echoing the famous IBM motto,
just think.
This is completely untrue. We are 2016 And who is using a brain-computer interface here in his daily activities? Just think, and your colleague gets called, or just think, you don't have to type anymore. It's not true, it's completely untrue. And I mean, I can, if you change the dates and make it 2016 and 2021, you can use the same movie again. So, how did it start? Neuroscience and artists were using brain-computer interfaces for the first time. Brainwaves were detected, were discovered by Hans Berger. I mentioned his name already in 1924. I will talk about it later, but he distinguished alpha waves, beta waves. There were others who were looking at other kinds of brain activity, at the frequencies, the amplitudes of the activity. These are some global observations on brain waves that you can measure all over your brains, usually. But of course, it's interesting to look at brain waves, at these frequencies, amplitudes, at certain regions of the brain, because then you get information about what's happening there. And probably, or hopefully, you can match it with intentions of the user or external stimuli to the user. So then you're becoming in an area where you can think of useful applications if you can indeed measure at these particular regions of the brain the activity. So this was in fact the first one that someone said, Sho Kamai, that you can manipulate your brain activity. You can do it yourself. Of course, there can be external stimuli, but you can also, for example, make a mental calculation, mental arithmetic, or to focus on a certain thing, or consciously trying to relax, for example, in meditation. So what he said, brain activity, people can recognize and manipulate this particular activity, brain waves, alpha waves. Interesting, it was done in 1968, so he also had a connection with LSD experience and things like that, because that was, of course, very popular that time. There were artists looking at that kind of brain activity. That was done after the Second World War, so 1970, 1972. For example, Nina Sobel was looking at how can people synchronize their brain activity? How can they synchronize their alpha activity? And if they can do that, can we make some kind of changes soundscape or a visual landscape? So can we manipulate certain drawings on a screen when two people try to cooperate and try to synchronize their brain activity? interesting thing is that in this case, John Lennon and Yoko Ono were using a headset together with David Rosenbaum, the composer, his composer, musician, and they were invited in TV shows. And so that shows, well, the time of the late 60s. And so Lennon and Yoko Ono were invited to use this brain device, and then they could improvise on music with their brain activity. So it was the auditory effects of the brain were integrated with the music made by David Rosenbaum. Chuck Vidal was the first one who mentioned brain-computer interfaces. So he was, this is a famous quotation. So, can these observable electrical brain signals be put to work as carriers of information in man-machine communication, or for the purpose of controlling such external apparatus as prosthetic devices or even spaceships? He used evoked responses, so stimuli from outside, and then see what's happening in your brain, and trying to convert this brain activity into commands, for example, to control a prosthetic device. At that time, you could not do that real time. So he also said something, well, at this moment we have to do it with something which he called batch processing, which was a new term at that moment. So, 1973, we see interest of people of man-computer communication, human-computer interaction, we say nowadays. But there was not really a continuation there of that interest. In fact, everything went to this clinical domain. Of course, there were interesting things that came from partly computer science, electrical engineering, so signal acquisition, feature extraction, machine learning, things like this. There were developments in neuroscience, so more knowledge about the brain became available by medical engineering. And we had the development of BCI paradigms, so different kinds of measuring brain activity and converted into commands. And there were BCI applications, but these were clinical BCI applications, such as neuroprosthetics and using BCI for neurorehabilitation. This is what we usually distinguish. You can have invasive or non-invasive BCI. Non-invasive is done with EEG, so it's from the skull. Then you can use it at the surface of the skull, of the cortex. So that's called ECOG, and you can really have implants, so intracortical recording of brain activity. Of course, the last one is the best one you can get, but it needs some kind of surgery, and usually in computer science we don't do that yet, fortunately. EEG has some advantages. So there are other methods in EEG. You look at the electrical activity. You can also look at the blood flow, for example, or the oxygen rate in blood. So that's called FNIRS. But EEG has advantages. It's non-invasive, low-cost, portable, and high temporal resolution. So you see immediately what's happening in the brain. Disadvantages, low spatial resolution, because it's coming from inside your brain, or maybe the top, but it has to pass your skull and the electrodes, and so you don't know exactly where it comes from. Well, it's about 1 centimeter, the spatial resolution, and the temporal resolution is milliseconds. A high noise ratio also for EEG has a disadvantage. And the high signal noise ratio is especially because of the artifact. So in your brain, a lot of things are happening. There may be external stimuli, but there are also eye movements. There are muscle movements. There is heartbeat. And all these things are reflected in your brain activity. So you really have to filter out what exactly you want, what exactly you can use. So there are a lot of methods for artifact removal. This is the position system that's standard. It's called the 1020 system. So when you do research on BCI, then you can talk about one particular electrode where you're measuring brain activity, or a group of electrodes where you measure activity. And you can talk with colleagues, or you can write about it, so you can compare results. So this is one of our students. She has a cap with 32 electrodes over there. And this is, in fact, the brain-computer interface cycle. I need these ones too. So you have the measurement of EEG. You have from the brain activity is processed, so there's signal analysis, feature extraction, classification, things like that. And there's a translation into a command, and then of course it goes back to the user who sees what the effect of the command is and can continue. Traditional and less traditional. Traditional brain activity is mapped on a cap, on a command. Less traditional, and that's now the human-computer interaction point of view, at least part of it. The first one is also interesting, but the second is also that the application monitors your brain activity and can use it. So it knows about your mental or your affective state, and it uses it in order to interpret commands you're doing. Not necessarily BCI commands, but whatever you're doing. And it can be used to make changes to the environment, to the way you can interact with the environment, and it can also be used for changes in the environment for future users. Of course, this last one, at this moment, it's not really of interest for clinical researchers. They are looking at this disabled persons and how can they help them. So BCI embedded in regular human-computer interaction. So this is the context in which we computer scientists look at BCI. That means that you look at the user, you have visual processing, you have visual information, you have audio information, you have tactile information. Of course, the user can also use keyboard and mouse. And you have other kinds of information, which is coming from physiological processes, including brain activity. So the idea is you are in a context, there's context-sensitive interpretation of the behavior, the human behavior, and there's also context-sensitive responding to the environment and to the user. So the environment is proactive and reactive. So another distinction we make is between voluntary and involuntary input. So in active BCI, the user intends to interact, so initiate brain activity voluntarily. Reactive, the user intends to interact. The brain activity is generated involuntarily in reaction to exogenous, so external stimulation. And passive BCI, the user does not intend to interact, but the system monitors the user and the system gets information about the user's mental state and does something useful with it. So let's look at BCI paradigms. It's a little introductory, but I assume that not many of you are using BCI or have looked at BCI, so it is kind of introduction. So I introduce some paradigms. For example, this one. This is called steady state visually evoked potential. Let's call it visually evoked potential. And you have different frequencies. It means these frequencies, it's going through the visual, to the visual cortex. In the visual cortex, you can really detect whether a user is looking at that frequency or that frequency. So it means you have a binary decision system. You can decide, I look at the top one, and that means yes. I look at the other one, and it means no. Or the top one means go to the left, and the lower one means go to the right. Things like that are possible. Other externally evoked potentials, it's called ERP, event-related potential. That is, you're interested in one particular item. So you see a lot of items passing by, for example, and then there is the one that you're interested in. And that repeats, so maybe 10 seconds later or 1 minute later, again this item appears. In fact, you can count the items that you are interested in. That's called ERP. And if such an item appears, then 300 milliseconds after that, there's a deflection in the brain activity. So that's called the P300. And a positive peak occurs then over the parietal cortex. The parietal cortex is over here. Everyone has a parietal cortex. An application. For example, you want to write without using your hands or whatever. You want to write a letter K, for example. So you have a matrix with rows and columns, and the rows and columns flash. The rows first, for example, then the columns going from left to right. And when the row with the K appears, then you have this P300, because that's the one you're interested in. You don't know exactly which letter, because there are many. So when the column goes, and then the column with the K appears, then again, you have this P300. So the system knows, okay, he is interested in the P300. Maybe not immediately, maybe you have to repeat it a few times. So, here see you what's happening. Now it stops because the K has been detected as the one you are interested in. So, another paradigm is alpha relaxation. So that's what Chokmai, the one I mentioned first, did with this experience with comparison with LSD and John Lennon and Yoko Ono. So you can be more or less relaxed. And that can happen in a natural way, but you can also intend to be more relaxed or less relaxed. So again, that's some kind of control you have. It can be converted, it can be changed into commands. So stress changes, if you monitor it, it can be done to make changes in the environment, or it can be done in order to issue commands. You can have more general paradigms. So you can imagine that you are angry. You can imagine that you are sad. So if you are able to detect that using EEG and that is possible, then you can use it as commands, rather unnatural, I think. So the semantics is very bad there. Conceptual imagery is maybe more interesting. So you think of a bicycle or a key. These are two different concepts, and they are different positions in your brain, if you think about the key or if you think about something else. So that can also be used in order to issue commands. So we did it, and we used it for World of Warcraft, for example. How many of you have played World of Warcraft? All of you could be sitting on the first row. Of course, there are a lot more people who played it, but I don't want to show it here. And in World of Warcraft, well, it's a role-playing game with lots of other people, and you can change from elf to bear. Sometimes you have to fight, and then it's good to be a bear. Sometimes you have to recover after a fight, then it's good to be an elf, because an elf has self-healing capacities. So if you are in this situation and you have to fight, then naturally you get aggressive, you get angry, and then you change from elf to bear. So the system just detects it from your brain activity and makes that change, or it goes the other way around. So let's go to the next, motor imagery. That's a very interesting one. Motor cortex over here, so about here, premotor, motor cortex. You can imagine certain movements. And you can imagine, for example, my feet, my left feet has to go to the left, or my right feet, or my right hand, or my tongue. All these things can be distinguished. So, for example, you can use imagined movements, imaginary movement, to navigate, to have a cursor moving. Okay, you can use it, for example, to play pong. Play pong is probably known. Yeah. So you have to move the bat up and down. So you can have two players, and each player uses this motor imagery in order to play this game. You can use it, for example, in a pinball situation, the left and the right, how do they call it, the pins who make the movements. You can use it, for example, for drone control. Okay, so these were the paradigms, the usual paradigms. So these are the things that you can use. So if you think of an application, you have to go back to these paradigms, because they can be, this kind of brain activity can be detected, and it can be translated into commands or changes into the environment. There's not more. Okay, there are some variations, but in fact, This is all. And you can imagine that for disabled persons, it's very useful to control, for example, a prosthetic device with motor imagery or with these other kinds of paradigms. So a few words about the future. So traditional BCI researchers, they were, hardly interested in non-clinical applications. So that's changing now a little. Hardly interested in computer science. So it's a quite different community, of course, people working in the clinical domain. And we computer scientists or whatever we are here, we are interested in intelligent systems, in artificial intelligence, and we can use it in order to make our systems, even our BCI systems, better. So we can talk about shared control. For example, in the case of a wheelchair, the environment has sensors, the wheelchair has sensors, the person who is sitting in the wheelchair has sensors. So that all can be used, and you don't have to give detailed commands with your brain to the wheelchair, but you can share control with all that's already there in the environment and in the intelligence in the environment. So we can look at a different way to BCI applications than what is usual in the clinical domain. I'll go to conclusions. Previously, many applications were one trick only, so just use motor imagery, just use this P300, just use this. And many applications assume disabled users. And now, I think that now there's more interest in different communities in BCI. We can design interfaces that use input from various BCI markers in parallel or sequential. We can embed BCI in intelligent artificial intelligence and multimodal interfaces. We can develop applications where people compete or collaborate using BCI. And we can, especially interesting or useful, applications in natural situations, including face-to-face human interaction. And of course, we need further development of technology, of electrodes, we need more neuroscience, etc. But hopefully that goes on. Okay, thank you.
Thank you so much.